Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. Today we are reviewing a mobile solar power station built on a hand truck. So unfortunately, when I built this mobile power station, I didn't have a YouTube channel at the time, so I didn't film any of it. So the best I could do is I provided a schematic to the system in case you were interested in how I built it. And that will be posted at the end of the video. And the reason I built this power station is because I wanted backup power that did not rely on fuel. And I also wanted to save power by running my household appliances 24/7 for 1 year. If you want to check out the video about powering household appliances, click on this link right here. You can also find the link in the description below. Features of this power station include unlimited power, as long as the sun comes up. It's mobile, somewhat. No fumes from burning fuel. And the DC side for powering small electronics without using the inverter. The AC side is powered by an MPP Solar LV2424. This is a 24-volt inverter and has a rated output of 2,400 watts, 2,000 watts of solar PV input, and a built-in 80-amp MPPT charger, so you do not need a separate charge controller. And I modified this hand truck by welding in a battery tray, so that when I'm moving the power station around, the battery does not fall off. The battery tray can hold a single 24-volt 200 amp hour battery that can provide up to 5.1 kilowatts hours of battery power. A second battery can be added off the cart for a total of 10.2 kilowatt hours of battery power. Let's talk about some of the other components on this board. These are DC to DC converters, otherwise known as buck converters. They convert 24 volts down to 12 volts usable power. Buck converters are commonly found in buses to power digital signage and in golf carts. There is a 20 amp converter and there is a 40 amp converter. These switches provide DC power to the USB outlets above. These panels provide 5 volt USB output for charging small electronics and has a 12 volt car adapter outlet as well. Now let's take a closer look at each component on the board and see how they interconnect. First, the battery connects to these distribution studs on the board via these 4-gauge wires using these Anderson connectors. From the distribution studs, DC power flows through this ANL fuse and up to the main DC breaker. And this breaker is a high-quality 48-volt breaker made by Blue Sea. It has an interrupt of 5,000 amps. That means if there's a DC arc, it can break that arc. And it is rated for marine applications. When building solar systems, be sure to always use high quality circuit protection devices. Power can either flow through the breaker once turned on, or this button can be pressed to pre-charge the system. From here, we can either power the DC side using the buck converters, or we can turn on the AC side to get AC power. On the AC side, the inverter converts the DC power to 120 volts AC and supplies power to this power strip over here. You can also hardwire GFCI outlets into an electrical gain box for your AC output. On the DC side, power flows through the main breaker and through these buck converters and up to these switches. When the switches are turned on, the USB panels will have power via the relays on the back of the board. A relay is an electrical device that can control a large amount of current with a small amount of current. And the USB panels are protected by this fuse box. When this switch is turned on, power is supplied to this 40 amp buck converter, which in turn supplies these terminals down below. And finally, going back to the battery, we have this Victron shunt. A shunt is used to monitor the status of the battery. It can monitor the state of charge of your battery and also tell you how much time you have left in your battery at the current load. Let's talk about the back of the power station. As you can see here, I used machine screws with nuts on the back of them for every single component. There's not a single screw on this board that does not have a nut. So this is the pre-charge circuit. It includes a push button that connects to a 200 ohm 25 watt resistor. And that basically gives a little bit of power to the inverter to pre-charge the system. So over here is the DC side. These are the switches and these are the relays which power the USB panels up here. Yes, and this is the blob. We'll talk about this later during the review of the schematic. Remember, I do the risky things on this channel so that you don't have to. That's my excuse anyway. I believe these are 12 gauge wires, all for the DC side, except for this. These wires are 8 gauge wires because it has to carry 40 amps. These are 40 amp rated DC 12 volt relays, automotive relays. And I ran all the wires as much as I could on the back side of the panel so that we would keep the front side as clean as possible. This right here, this is the AC input. We can plug this into the grid to get our AC power. This is a heavy duty extension cord and it's rated for 20 amps and it has 12 gauge wire. If you use an extension cord for your AC input, make sure that you use a heavy duty extension cord. This breaker right here is the PV input breaker. It's a DC rated breaker for 110 volts and it is mounted on a DIN rail. So these MC4 connectors are where the PV array connects to. This uni strut is welded onto the hand truck and then I painted it black. Same with down here, we have the same uni strut, straight bolt, straight bolt, and straight bolt. Through the frame, U-bolt resting on the D-handle, U-bolt resting on the D-handle. All the weight really comes down, it's on these handles. It's on the frame. So yeah, that's the backside. So one thing I didn't show, because it's hard to see, is the top. So I have this kind of non-slip adhesive material stuck to the top of this board here. But yeah, this is great for your phone. You put your phone on top, just like that. Whatever you're charging, whatever devices you're using, you just put it right on top and then plug it into the USB. So one of the key features of this inverter and any off-grid inverter is that it should have an automatic transfer switch. The automatic transfer switch provides three key functions, the most important of which is when your battery state of charge gets too low, it'll switch to the grid power to charge your battery. The second thing that it provides is overload or surge protection. If I were to power a large device that required a huge amount of initial surge power, such as a clothes dryer, the inverter would see that and would switch over to the grid power to power that device. The third feature is grounding for your AC output. As you can see, the ground LED on the AC output power strip is not lit. When I plug in the AC input to the grid, we will have grounding. And now our AC devices plugged into the power strip have proper grounding. Now that we have the AC input of the inverter connected to the grid, we're going to use this green extension cord, run it to the clothes dryer, and we're going to demonstrate the surge protection of this inverter. So let's watch the screen as we turn on the dryer and see what happens with the inverter. Now that the dryer is turned on and running, we can see that the inverter saw a surge. We're starting the dryer and it switched over to the grid power. So we can see that when the dryer is actually running, it only uses about 600 watts. So after about 10 minutes, the inverter will see that this is not actually a surge situation, and it'll turn off the grid power and start running that dryer off the battery only. And most inverters are built to handle surge for a matter of just a few seconds. That's why there's capacitors inside, so that when there's a heavy demand, those capacitors can meet that demand. Most inverters will have a surge rating of about twice of its actual output rating. This particular inverter is a 2400 watt inverter, so that's 4800 watt surge. Before we look at the schematic, I want to mention a couple of things. Always be sure to mount the inverter on a non-flammable surface. Do not do what I did. If you do decide to use wood, layer the wood with a thin piece of concrete board. I am not a professional, and this is informational only. Let's take a look at the schematic. All right, so looking at the schematic, there are three main sections. We have on the very left, we have the legend. It shows a few of the components with their schematics, with their pinouts. We've got the 12-volt automotive relay with its pinout. So you can identify that on the schematic. The switch with its pinouts, and also the buck converters. There is a 20-amp and a 40-amp buck converter, so one is larger. These components are all for the DC side. So again, if you're not going to build a DC side, then it's completely optional. You don't need it. So the next section is the AC side. And if you want to just build the basic system,
All you need to do is worry about the stuff in the AC side. You don't even need this 20 amp inline fuse. And I think you want everything else except shunt is optional. I think the shunt is an awesome device to have. So I would call it a critical device, but you don't need that either. But everything else you should have. So going to the DC side, I want to mention a few things. First of all, I want to mention, remember the blob? We talked about the blob earlier. And what that is this B1 and B2 at the upper right, these the positive and negative junction blocks, distribution blocks. What that is, if you look at the 20 amp buck converter output, it's basically these yellow lines, the B1 lines, B1, B1, and B1. It goes to the switch, and it goes to the relays, and it goes also over to the power LED for the positive side. And for the negative line, you have B2s, the B2 and B2, and also another, where's the other B2? Over here. So you got the LED on the switches, you got the negative on the power LED, and you got the negative on the fuse box, and you got the negative on the relays. So when I built the system, I didn't have these distribution blocks, so I just kind of ended up blobbing everything together. That's why you ended up with a blob. So yeah, I would definitely recommend installing these distribution blocks on the back of the board, so that way you have a nice connecting point for all your for these junctions for the 12 volt circuit. And the last thing I want to mention for the DC side is these the USB panel outlets. You can see up here that it's a modified circuit. So when you purchase the thing, the switch, the built-in switch, controls power to both the car adapter outlet and the USB outlet. So I didn't want to do that. I wanted to have separate circuits. I wanted the car adapter on one circuit and I wanted the USB outlet on another circuit. So the switch on this diagram, the switch only controls power to the car outlet, and that's on a 15 amp circuit. And the USB outlets, if you look really close, there's actually a little button. That little button turns on and off the power for the USB outlet. So there's no point to having a switch to something you can turn off individually anyway. So, and these run on a 10 amp circuit. You don't even need that. You can run these on a 5 amp circuit. All you need is 3 amps for a USB outlet. And so just note that this is a modified circuit. You don't have to do it this way. You can just wire these panels as they come when you buy them to the fuse box. So that's about it. You could also alternatively, I mean, I wouldn't really recommend it, but you can use the fuse box. The negative fuse box bus bar is essentially a bus bar. They're all connected together. This is B2A. So B2A, you can connect all the B2s optionally to the fuse box bus bar negative side. But then you're kind of wasting that bus bar connections for other circuits that you can potentially add to your fuse block. So it's probably best just to go in with these terminal distribution terminal blocks, the B1 and B2. And that's how I would do it. So I'll eventually put a schematic on my website with the B1 and B2 blocks, and it'll be rewired for that.
If you are a beginner, I suggest using all-in-one inverter because they are easy to use and have fewer components. Just hook up a battery and some solar panels and you're good to go. Pretty much. So how much did this system cost to build? $3,000 for two batteries, $750 for the inverter, $1,400 for 2,000 watts of solar panels, about $300 for all the components that you see on the board, except for the inverter. So the shunt, the cabling, fuse, breaker, buck converter, switch, fuse, box, and the USB panels, and the cabling for the battery. For a total cost of about $5,500. If you want to see a video about how much I've saved on my power bill using this power station, click on the link here. You can also find it in the description. Remember, safety first, and always use proper circuit protection. And as always, thanks for watching.